Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Releasing Miracles, How to Walk in the Supernatural Power of God by Kynan Bridges. Narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. Foreword. Dr. Kynan Bridges has been a frequent guest on my It's Supernatural television show and has served on my board of directors for many years, so I can really say I know him. Releasing Miracles could well be Kynan's best and most important book. Why? Because we are entering the time when we will witness what Jesus referred to as the greater works. I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works. John chapter 14, verse 12, New Living Translation. What will be greater than the blind seeing, the deaf hearing, and the dead being raised? How about praying in the amputee ward of a hospital and seeing limbs restored before your very eyes? How about witnessing just one person rise from the dead, but hundreds in one city at one time? How about laying hands on cancer patients whose flesh was destroyed and watching it be instantly restored? How about seeing this happen live on the secular TV news networks? There will be so much good news, they won't have time for the other. We need the greater works. The world is too far gone. It is beyond help from politics. It cannot be restored by man. The devil has made his best move. Now it's God's turn. He is our only hope, and he is more than enough. I have concentrated on miracles for my entire 50 years of public ministry. Miracles are how Jesus reached the multitudes with the good news. And miracles are how I reach large numbers of Jewish people today. Last week I led an outreach meeting in Israel with 950 unsaved Jewish Israelis in attendance. During this meeting, large numbers of these non-believers raised their hands to signify they had just been healed. Then well over 900 of them boldly stood up and publicly proclaimed Jesus as Messiah and Lord. Without the miracles, this would never have happened. This was as historic as what was recorded in the books of Acts at Pentecost. The working of miracles was God's number one method to evangelize the first church, and God has never changed. We are coming into the greatest harvest of souls in history. The least follower of Jesus in the first church walked in miracles. How much more must we walk in miracles just before his return? Releasing Miracles is written for evangelicals who have never walked in or even believed in modern-day miracles, as well as for charismatics who believe in miracles but see very few. Kynan teaches first from the Bible, then from first-hand experience. Many will receive a supernatural impartation flowing from the words of this book to walk in miracles. As miracles are released in this end-time move of God's Spirit, it will galvanize the true church. God is sending out a shofar blast mandate worldwide. He is saying, all hands on deck. This is God's time for you to walk in the greater works, the greater miracles. It's time for you to be normal. That's normal as defined by the Bible. Sid Israel Roth, host, It's Supernatural. 1. Miracles, our spiritual inheritance. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. John chapter 14, verse 12. As the scorching sun beat upon his face, the noise of the crowd grew as each person pushed their way closer and closer to the pool, growing so loud now that he couldn't even hear himself think, nor could he move his paralyzed body closer to the pool. Suddenly, the voices of the multitude dimmed, and a single voice became clearer and clearer. "Will you be made whole?" he asked, his voice so gentle and yet so powerful it could be heard above the noise, as if every other voice faded away. The face of a stranger towering over his frail body seemed so eerily familiar. "Rise, take up your bed, and walk." The command was given with such authority, he couldn't even resist. Immediately, his body began to quake from within, as he could hear the cracking of bone and feel the stretching of his muscle tissues. His ligaments and tendons felt like they were snapping back into place. Suddenly, he stood on his feet, perplexed and yet relieved. After 38 years of paralysis and a stagnant existence by a pool he had never once entered, the man was totally healed and restored. He received a miracle. This is my own dramatized version of one of my favorite biblical accounts, the story of the man at the pool of Bethesda. I believe it paints the perfect picture of the omnibenevolence of God in performing a miracle for a man who was undeserving. In fact, it is no coincidence that the miracle takes place there, because the word Bethesda literally means house of mercy. Could it be that this miracle of divine restoration paints a vivid picture for us of the underlying purpose for miracles? Let's explore. Why miracles? All my life, I have wondered about God and the supernatural. From the first time I read the Bible, I knew intuitively there must be something more to this world than what I could see with my natural eyes. Unfortunately, when I would speak to other Christians, there wasn't much talk of miracles. Granted, we learned a lot about the moral responsibilities of Christians. For example, don't lie, don't steal, don't cheat, don't chew or hang with those who do. It was, however, a strange thing to ask someone, "How many miracles did you experience today?" And even if you asked that question, some would respond by saying, "The fact that I am still breathing is a miracle," or "Every day is a miracle." With this, I would agree to an extent. There is nothing wrong with seeing every day as a miracle, but if we are going to be faithful to the Word of God, we need to acknowledge that God had a specific definition in mind when He introduced the concept of miracles in Scripture. So before we can answer that question, why miracles, you may be wondering, what are miracles? I am very glad that you asked. The Bible says that Jesus of Nazareth was approved of God by miracles, signs, and wonders. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know. Acts chapter 2, verse 22, King James Version. The word approved here comes from the Greek word apodeknomi, which means to point away from oneself, to show forth, to expose to view or to prove by demonstration. In other words, Jesus' ministry was filled with miracles, and these miracles pointed people to the King and His kingdom, demonstrating His power. The word for miracles here is rendered from the Greek word dynamis, which literally means demonstrative power, dynamic power, or the power to perform miracles. In the ancient world, power had to be demonstrated in order to confirm the truth and veracity of that power. If God is real, He must possess the ability to perform miracles. Another definition of a miracle, according to the Oxford Dictionary, is a surprising and welcome event that is not explicable by natural or scientific laws and is therefore considered to be the work of a divine agency. I like to define a miracle as an intervention, interruption, or overriding of natural laws by God, or when eternity invades time. The argument for miracles. The presence of miracles is proof, from a logical and philosophical standpoint, that God is real. Why? If God is a supernatural being, then the presence of the supernatural points to the reality of God. Furthermore, how can anyone claim to follow a supreme being who is incapable of affecting the natural world? If God is omnipotent, then He must have the ability to heal disease and raise the dead. These are the very things that characterized the ministry of Jesus. Again, Acts chapter 2, verse 22 tells us that Jesus was approved of God by signs and wonders. The question would be, are our churches today approved by the same standard as the first century church? I believe that where miracles begin, arguments end. The truth is, this generation longs for an authentic display of the presence and power of God. People don't just want to hear about the God of the Bible. They want to experience him in a very real and tangible way. I believe there is a clarion call to the church to walk in and release the miraculous power of God on a daily basis. We said earlier that a miracle is defined as an intervention in or an overriding of a natural law or process. According to this definition, miracles happen when heaven literally invades the earth. Every time a miracle takes place, the sovereignty and love of God are established in the hearts and minds of the recipients or witnesses to those miracles. Glory to God! The crack addicts on the street may not understand systematic theology, but they understand being delivered from the power of addiction. The prostitute on the corner or the woman being trafficked may not know anything about hermeneutics or homiletics, but she knows what it means to be liberated from the power of perversion. Unfortunately, many well-meaning Christians, including spiritual leaders, have participated in the great omission. They have omitted the power of God from the gospel. By doing so, they have effectively removed God from the gospel, and if he is omitted, then all you have left is a spell. Many people in the American church are under the spell of intellectualism, which has given birth to a powerless Christianity. The good news is that millions of Christians all over the world are experiencing a hunger for the supernatural power of God. What does love look like? What if I told you that the Bible was not simply a theological book or a historical record of the ancient world? Yes. The Bible does contain those things, but I believe the Bible is so much more. I believe that the Bible is literally an open letter to humanity, articulating the heart and mind of God. More specifically, I believe that the gospel is a love story to humankind, and this love story was demonstrated through the greatest miracle in the history of the world, the incarnation, death, burial, and resurrection of our Messiah, Jesus Christ. Think about this for a moment. The greatest story ever told is a love story that is essentially a story of miracles. Miracles are a manifestation of God's love for the human race. God redeemed humanity because he loves humanity. See John chapter 3, verse 16. God heals humanity because he loves humanity. God reveals himself through miracles to humanity because he loves humanity. The question when it comes to miracles is, what does love look like? To the man at the pool of Bethesda who had been in that condition for 38 years, love looked like, rise, take up your mat and walk. Can you imagine the joy he experienced? Can you imagine the look on his face? If you told that man that God loved him, do you think he would believe it? To the Samaritan woman, trapped in a life of immorality, love looked like a conversation at the well with Jesus, where the secrets of her heart were revealed and a radical face-to-face encounter with the Messiah took place. In a moment, her life was supernaturally transformed because she received living water. To a young man sitting in his living room watching Christian television and listening to a televangelist talk about the Holy Spirit, love looked like experiencing God come into his living room and radically saving him and filling him with the Holy Ghost. That young man was me. If you are listening to this book, you are part of a remnant of believers who will actively partner and participate in what I believe to be the next great move of God. This is not some dramatic statement inserted for emotional effect. This is a sincere and genuine declaration for what I believe to be the heart of God for this generation. Miracles are not just random occurrences or spontaneous manifestations of an impersonal universe, but they are the deliberate displays of love by an omnibenevolent God, an all-good God. They are, indeed, our inheritance. Miracles are our portion. Merriam-Webster defines an inheritance as 1. The act of getting by legal right from a person at his or her death or through heredity. 2. Something gotten by legal right from a person at his or her death. In short, Jesus died to give a spiritual inheritance. Scripture speaks of this very explicitly. Most assuredly, I say to you, He who believes in me, the works that I do he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. John chapter 14, verse 12. We are empowered to do what Jesus did. Why? Because I go unto the Father. Jesus' journey to the Father began with the cross. The cross was the doorway he went through in order to fulfill God's plan of redemption. As a result, he, Jesus, has given us his Spirit so that the same works that he did, we would also do. What were the works that Jesus did? God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, and Jesus went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. Acts chapter 10, verse 38. Jesus worked miracles. He healed the sick. He expelled demons. Those were the works that he did. If we are supposed to do what he did and greater, then we, too, should be walking in the supernatural power of God. In fact, the Bible says, "And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons, they will speak with new tongues." Mark chapter 16, verse 17. What would happen if you and I thought about miracles as our portion or inheritance rather than something we performed? Inheritance implies heredity. In other words, the miraculous is inextricably connected to our born-again nature in Christ. We will explore this in more detail later. Just like anything you inherit, acknowledgement and recognition are necessary in order to release the portion that has been given to you. Increased awareness increases authority. I have realized in my journey in the miraculous that the more you are aware of who He is, who you are, and what you possess on the inside, the more authority you have to operate in miracles. Jesus asked a profound question in the gospel account found in Matthew chapter 16, verse 3. When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" Jesus posed this question in a significant place, Caesarea Philippi. This was a popular site of the renowned Temple of Pan in the first century. People came from all over the Roman Empire to worship idols. We don't have any evidence for this, but I am willing to bet that it was probably very crowded and loud when Jesus posed this question. There is something prophetic about that potential detail alone. Who do people say Jesus is in the midst of all the cultural noise around us? What do people perceive him to be? But the second question is even more profound than the first. He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Verse 15. Jesus wanted to know who his disciples perceived him to be. Was he simply one of the prophets? Was he John the Baptist reincarnated? Did they share the same sentiments of the masses who watched him from afar? Then Peter stood up and exclaimed, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Verse 16. To this Jesus responded, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Verses 17 through 19. The revelation of the person of Jesus was, and is, an essential ingredient to the foundation of the church and the authority of the believer. Jesus referred to keys. This is the Greek word kleis, denoting power and authority of various kinds. In other words, there is a correlation between revelation and authority. The greater the revelation of who Jesus is, the greater the authority to release his power. This is why the question of, "Who do you say I am?" is so important. If Jesus is simply a theological concept, then that is all we will be able to offer people. But if he truly is the Christ, the Anointed One and His anointing, who is the source of all miracles, then we will be able to offer the miraculous to everyone around us. A personal story of a miracle. My wife shared a very powerful testimony with me of a miracle that she received. Several years ago, she was diagnosed with a cyst on her ovaries. The doctors gave her a very negative prognosis. But my wife is a woman of great faith and expectancy. She determined in herself that she was going to receive a miracle from God. Every day she came to church, she would declare that the cyst on her ovaries was dissolved. During the teaching, she would feel a burning sensation in her ovaries. This was not a painful burning, but it felt like the fire of God was burning up the cyst. This went on for several weeks, until one day she went to the doctor, and he confirmed that the cyst had totally disappeared. Glory to God! There are times when people will go to a miracle crusade and have a powerful healing evangelist lay hands on them, and they will experience a supernatural healing. Those are some awesome experiences. But God can move supernaturally through what we would call everyday people. No one laid hands on my wife to receive a miracle, yet she released her faith for the miraculous because she believed with all her heart that the miraculous is her inheritance. You should believe the same for you. Miracles are your right. One of the things that I often hear when speaking to many well-meaning Christians is that God will do something for us if it's His will. I have heard this statement literally thousands of times. Trust me when I say I know the heart behind this statement. It is an effort to acknowledge the sovereignty of God. Please understand that the sovereignty of God will never abdicate the authority of the believer, nor will it remove our spiritual rights as citizens in the kingdom of God. This is one of the most foundational truths that you must understand if you are to live in a sustained flow of the power and presence of God. As audacious as it may sound, you must know that a miracle doesn't just take place because God is in a particular mood on a particular day. On the contrary, miracles are a part of a spiritual inheritance given to us through Jesus and His efficacious work on the cross. The moment you and I were born again, we received the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, and therefore we have received the same dynamis power, the power to perform miracles. I know that comment may make some conservative theologians turn over in their graves, but I can assure you that it is absolutely scriptural. Every believer has been given the divine right to operate in the miraculous. Next, I'd like to draw our attention to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Now to Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Did you notice that the Apostle Paul says explicitly that God's ability to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think is according to the power that works in us? There are two words I want to expound upon in this text. The first is the word according, derived from the Greek word kata, an interesting word, which can be rendered down from or throughout. Now, when you hear it in that context, it gives the passage a different meaning. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we can ask or think down from the power that works in us. God's omnipotent ability flows down from or throughout the power that works in us. This brings me to the second word that I would like to define in this text. The word power comes from the Greek word dynamis, which literally means miracle working power, or the power to perform miracles, or the power resident in a thing by virtue of its nature. In other words, God's ability to work for us or through us is inextricably connected to the measure of His power working in us. Imagine that a wealthy businessman bought a Bugatti sports car, valued at over $1 million, and this sports car was capable of reaching 200 miles per hour, with an engine capable of 1,000 horsepower. Now imagine that this businessman only drove the car back and forth to work in stop-and-go traffic or on residential streets with a speed limit of 35 miles per hour. It would be safe to say that he is not maximizing the full potential of the vehicle. Why? Even though his car is capable of massive amounts of power, his gas pedal is only demanding minimal amounts of power from the engine because of his driving habits. Now imagine that this same driver was given the opportunity to drive on the Autobahn in Germany, or on an open highway in Dubai or the salt flats of Utah. Would he experience a totally different vehicle? In many ways, we have been given access to operate in the unlimited power of God, yet many Christians are stuck in spiritual traffic, only seeing a limited measure of what God desires to do in and through them. They have to put their pedal to the metal and release the supernatural power of God, so they are experiencing small doses of the supernatural, rather than the deluge they have inherited in Christ. Summary questions. 1. What are miracles and why are they important? 2. How do miracles demonstrate God's love for humanity? 3. Why does every believer have the divine right to operate in miracles? 4. What does our spiritual inheritance in Christ include? Miracle activation. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for the inheritance that I have received in Christ. I thank you that you have given me the miraculous as a divine birthright. I will walk in the full expression of this divine birthright. Thank you for the working of your mighty power in and through me in a way that brings you honor. Let people experience your presence through the words that I speak and the actions that I take. From today forward, I will receive my inheritance. I embrace the truth that I am your child, and as your child, your Spirit operates in and through me to the glory of your name. Holy Spirit, have your way in my life in Jesus' name. Amen. 2. Jesus, the blueprint of the miraculous. And it came to pass on a certain day, as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town of Galilee, and Judea, and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Luke chapter 5, verse 17, King James Version. Crowds gathered around the house. There were so many people that you could hardly see beyond the person standing in front of you. As the multitudes pressed closer and closer to the house, they could hear the one so many had spoken about. The rabbi was teaching. Suddenly, you could hear the sound of wood breaking above the place where the master was teaching. The knocking sound grew louder and louder as light broke in from the ceiling. What was happening? The strangest thing had taken place. A paralytic man was let down through the roof as a deafening silence pierced the atmosphere. The Messiah gazed at the man with an unbroken stare as hundreds watched to see what he would say. A palpable presence hovered over the crowd. "Man, your sins are forgiven you," the Messiah said with a serious face. Now the silence had turned into the sporadic sounds of shock by the religious leaders. Before the crowd could gather themselves, the Messiah said, "Which is easier, to say, 'Your sins are forgiven you,' or to say, 'Rise up and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins." Then he told the paralyzed man, "I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house." Immediately the man who was let down through the roof by his faithful friends took up his mat and walked for the first time since anyone could remember. How was this possible? What manner of man was this? Understanding the blueprint. I can only imagine the scene of the miracle recorded in the Gospel of Luke. The man with the palsy was forever changed by the healing power of the Christ. How did this miracle impact his life? How did it affect the atmosphere? What happened in the hearts and minds of the onlookers? These are questions we may not often ask when reading biblical accounts such as this one, but these are not simply anecdotal stories from ancient folklore. These are real-life accounts of real people who encountered a very real God. So far, we have talked about the fact that miracles are not simply sporadic occurrences, but are part of our spiritual inheritance as New Testament believers. Every miracle ever done by our Lord left an indelible mark on those who received them. As we continue along this line of understanding the purpose, power, and practical keys to releasing the miraculous, it is important for us to gain a greater insight into the spiritual blueprint that God has established in His Word for miracles. Everything in the kingdom of God follows a spiritual blueprint. What do I mean by this? I am very glad you asked. The blueprint is defined as a design plan or other technical drawing. It is essentially a schematic or framework for something that allows that thing to be reproduced the way it was originally intended. Another way of looking at a blueprint is by thinking of it as a pattern. For example, in Exodus chapter 25, verses 8 through 9, God said this to Moses, "And let them make me a sanctuary, that I may dwell among them. According to all that I show you, that is, the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all its furnishings, just so you shall make it." This is a very profound spiritual principle. God instructed Moses to build a sanctuary according to the pattern of the tabernacle. What pattern was he referring to? The Bible answers this question in verse 40 of the same chapter. "And see to it that you make them according to the pattern which was shown you on the mountain." God showed Moses a heavenly pattern when he was on Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights. This means that everything that was built on the earth was built according to the pattern that had already been established in heaven. In other words, the heavenly tabernacle was the blueprint for the earthly tabernacle. On earth as in heaven. Jesus made a very powerful statement in response to the request of his disciple Philip to show him the Father. "Have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, 'Show us the Father'?" John chapter 14, verse 9. These words of Jesus are a theological game changer. Jesus tells us that he is the express image of the Father. See Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. If we want to know the nature, character, and heart of the Father, all we need to do is look at Jesus, because Jesus is the embodiment of the spiritual blueprint of heaven. He is the pattern. He is the example. In fact, Jesus tells us that he only does what he sees the Father do. Then Jesus answered and said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he sees the Father do. For whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner." John chapter 5, verse 19. Jesus not only follows the blueprint, but he is the blueprint. He looks at the Father and demonstrates his love by performing miracles, and we must look at Jesus and demonstrate his love by releasing miracles. This is why Jesus said in the model prayer found in Matthew chapter 6, verse 10, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Just as Moses was given the pattern in heaven and instructed to reproduce on earth what he saw in heaven, we as the church are called to release miracles according to the pattern, which is Jesus himself. Jesus is our example. Jesus is the spiritual template for what is possible and how to release miracles. Jesus shows us who the Father is by doing what the Father does. The declaration, "On earth as it is in heaven," is a clarion call to the church to walk out the reality of the miraculous according to the divine blueprint which is already established in the heavenly realm. As much as some would like to assert, it's not about miracles, it's about the gospel. The reality is that Jesus' ministry was characterized by the miraculous. If it is about the gospel of Christ, as so many claim, then what the Apostle Paul declared in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, should be at the very core of our theology. "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first, and also for the Greek." The Bible says that the gospel of Christ is the very source of the dynamis, or miracle-working power of God. Inextricably connected to the gospel is the power to perform miracles. So when people say it is about the gospel, they are absolutely right, but at the center of the gospel is the power of God to salvation. Romans chapter 1, verse 16, King James Version. There is a condition to that statement in Scripture, for everyone who believes. Do you believe it? Access has been granted. What if I told you that the doors you have been waiting on to open in your spiritual life have already been opened? How would that change the way you approach the things of God? How would that change the way you pray? You would probably have more confidence and more authority in your spiritual life. Guess what? The door to the miraculous was opened 2,000 years ago. That's right. You are not waiting on God to use you, a concept I will address in a later chapter, but God is waiting on you to simply believe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.